Arundhati Roy is the author of the novel A God of Small Things, for which she received the 1997 Booker Prize. She has written several nonfiction books, including The Cost of Living, Power Politics, War Talk, An Ordinary Person's Guide to Empire, Public Power in the Age of Empire. It says here that your new book is Field Notes on Democracy, but then that's Broken Republic is since then. So that's your newest book is Broken Republic, right? So yeah, her second new book is Field Notes on Democracy, Listening to Grasshoppers, and her new book is Broken Republic, which is absolutely fantastic, I think the best one. Anyway, so here's Arundhati Roy.
What are you looking at me for? Should I just...
Oh, yeah, go. Okay. Speak if you wish.
Thanks, everybody, for being here and for inviting me here. I can't tell you how delighted I was to look at all this trouble that's brewing in paradise. There are so many things that I want to say, but let me just start by saying that every kind of resistance that has been discussed here in theory is being carried out in practice where I live. And so to begin with, I want to salute the people who live in one of the poorest countries in the world, India, for stopping some of the biggest corporations in their tracks for the last 5 or 6 years. So let's just say salam to them. So you know, I don't know how far back in history to begin, so I'll lay the milestone down in the recent past. Let's say in the early 90s, when capitalism won its war against Soviet communism in the bleak mountains of Afghanistan, the Indian government, which had been for many years one of the leaders of the non-aligned movement, suddenly became a completely aligned country and began to call itself the natural ally of the US and Israel. And it opened up its protected markets to global capital. So what I'm going to talk about is roughly what happened in the last, let's say, 20, 21 years. And though what most people have been speaking about is about environmental battles, in the real world, actually, it's quite hard to separate these things. You know, the war on terror, for example, the depleted uranium, the missiles, the fact that it was the military-industrial complex that actually pulled the U.S. out of the Depression, out of the Great Depression. And since then, the economies of countries like America, many countries in Europe, certainly Israel, have depended very largely on the manufacture of weapons. And what good are weapons if they're not going to be used in wars? So it's absolutely essential. It's not just for oil or for natural resources, but for the military-industrial complex itself to keep going, that we need weapons. So today, as we speak, the US and perhaps China and India are involved in a battle for control of the resources of Africa. Tens of thousands of US troops are being sent, death squads and troops are being sent into Africa. The Yes We Can president has expanded the war from Afghanistan into Pakistan, their drone attacks, killing children every day there. But what, I mean, just to look at the process of how things panned out in India, before I begin to read to you from the Broken Republic, which is actually called Walking with the Comrades here in the US. I just want to, you know, sort of structurally put something in place. So in the 1990s, when the markets of India opened, when all the laws that protect labor were dismantled, when natural resources were privatized, and that whole process was set into motion, the Indian government basically opened two locks. One was the lock of the markets, and the other was the lock of an old 14th century mosque called the Babri Masjid, which was a disputed site between Hindus and Muslims, because the Hindus believed that it was the birthplace of Ram, and the Muslims, of course, used it as a mosque. And by opening that lock, it set into motion a kind of conflict between the majority community and the minority community, a way of constantly dividing people. And this is the main practice of anybody that is in power. How do you divide people? It doesn't, and so this was one of them. So the opening of these two locks unleashed two kinds of totalitarianism in India. One was economic totalitarianism, and the other was, you know, Hindu fundamentalism. And both these processes manufactured two kinds of what the government calls terrorism. So you had Islamist terrorists, and you had today what the government calls Maoists, which means anybody who's resisting the project of civilization, of progress, of development, anybody who's resisting the takeover of their lands or the destruction of rivers and forests is today a Maoist. Yes, there are Maoists. They are the most militant end of a bandwidth of resistance movements, starting from the Gandhians to the Maoists. And what kind of strategy people will choose or adopt to resist the onslaught of global capital quite often is not an ideological choice, it's a tactical choice, depending on the landscape in which those battles are being fought. But everybody is a Maoist. I mean, just this morning I received an email from India talking about a woman called Soni Sori, an indigenous tribal woman who'd just been arrested the day before, or a few days before I left India, and, you know, she's now being held and tortured and being asked to name some of us as the sort of overground leaders of the Maoist movement, which is absolutely ridiculous. But anyway, ever since India became a sovereign republic, it has deployed its army against what it calls its own people since 1947. In Manipur, in Nagaland, in Mizoram, in Kashmir, where there are 700,000 Indian troops, where there were 165,000 American troops in the war in Iraq. And now, gradually, those states where the troops were deployed were people who were fighting for self-determination. They were states that the decolonized Indian state immediately colonized. But now those troops are actually defending the government's rights to build big dams, to build power projects, to carry out the processes of privatization. In the last 50 years, more than 30 million people have been displaced by big dams alone in India. And of course, most of those are indigenous people or people who live off the land. So the results of 20 years of this kind of free market and this bogey of terrorism has resulted in the hollowing out of democracy. So I notice a lot of people use democracy as a good word, but actually, if you think of it, democracy today is not what democracy used to be. There was a time when the American government was toppling democracies in Latin America and all over the place. Today, it's waging wars to install democracy because it has taken democracy into the workshop and hollowed it out. It has every institution of democracy, let's say in India, whether it's the courts, whether it's the parliament, whether it's the press, all of it has been hollowed out and harnessed to the free market. So you have these empty rituals, but what actually happens is it continues to militarize. It continues to become a police state, which is what has happened in India. So in the last 20 years, after we embraced the free market, 250,000 farmers have committed suicide because they have been driven into debt. 250,000 farmers. This has never happened in human history before. And yet, you know, obviously when the establishment has a choice between suicide farmers and suicide bombers, you know which ones they're going to encourage. They don't mind that statistic because it helps them. They feel sorry, they make a few noises, but they keep doing what they're doing. Today, India has more poor people than all the poorest countries of Africa put together. And it has 80% of its population living on less than 20 rupees a day, which is less than 50 cents a day. So that is the atmosphere in which the resistance movements are operating. And of course, it has a media which I don't know any other country which has so many news channels, all of them sponsored by either directly owned by corporations, some of them mining corporations, infrastructure corporations, and some of them, more than 99% of all news is funded by corporate advertising. So you can imagine what's going on with that. We have a prime minister, the prime minister of the world's largest democracy, Manmohan Singh, who was more or less installed by the IMF. He has never won an election in his life. He never stood for, he stood for one election loss, but after that he was just placed there. And he's the person who actually, when he was finance minister, dismantled all the laws and allowed global capital into India. I remember at one time I was at a meeting of iron ore workers, and Manmohan Singh, the prime minister at that time, was the leader of the opposition, and a Hindi poet read out a poem. It was called Manmohan Singh Kya Kar Raha Hai Aajkal, which means, what is Manmohan Singh doing these days? And it started, and the first two lines were, Manmohan Singh Kya Kar Raha Hai Aajkal, Vish Kya Karta Hai Khoon Mein Utarne Ke Baad, what does poison do after it's entered the bloodstream? You know, because they knew that whatever he had to do was done, and now it's just a question of it taking its course. So in 2005, which was the second term of the present government, the Indian government signed hundreds of memorandums of understanding with mining companies, with infrastructure companies, and so on, to convert a huge swathe of forest land in central India. India has 100 million indigenous peoples. And they have, if you look at a map of India, the minerals, the forests, and the indigenous people are all stacked up, one on top of the other. And so these Memorandums of understanding were signed with these mining companies in 2005. At the same time that those memorandums of understanding were signed, in the state of Chhattisgarh, which is where this great civil war is unfolding now, the government raised a tribal militia, which was funded by these corporations, to basically go through the forest and try and clear it of people so that the MOUs, the memorandums of understanding, could be actualized. So the media started to call this whole swathe of forest the Maoist corridor. Well, some of us used to call it the MOUist corridor. And around that time, they announced a war, basically. It was called Operation Green Hunt. And 200,000 paramilitary began to move into the forests, along with this tribal militia, to clear it of what the government called Maoists. Now, the Maoist movement in various avatars has existed in India since 1967, which was the first time there was an uprising in a village in West Bengal called Naxalbari. So the Maoists are sometimes called Naxalites. And of course, it's a underground band party. It has now a People's Liberation Guerrilla Army. You know, thousands and thousands of people have been killed in this conflict. Today, there are thousands of people in prison. All of them are called Maoists, though not all of them are Maoists. Because as I said, anybody who resists today is being called a terrorist. Poverty and terrorism have been conflated. And we have laws like in Kashmir and in the northeastern states, you have the Armed Forces Special Powers Act, which allows soldiers to kill on suspicion. In central India, you have laws like, I mean, all over India, you have the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, which basically makes even thinking an anti-government thought a criminal offense, for which you can be jailed for more than 7 years. So this is the atmosphere that was being created, and the media was in this orgy of, you know, these Maoist terrorists. They were conflating them with the Lashkar-e-Taiba, you know, so you'd see them on TV with these sort of ski masks and AK-47s, and the middle class was literally baying for their blood. And at this time, I had written a couple of a couple of articles about the whole thing, where television anchors would just turn around and look at me as if I was crazy when I mentioned mining. You know, what was the connection between pure evil guerrillas and good mining corporations? You know, so in this book, Field Notes on Democracy, there's a point where the Supreme Court of India actually gave a judgment saying you cannot possibly accuse a corporation of malpractice. In so many words, it just says so. So it was around that time that a note was slipped under my door inviting me to go into the forest and walk with the comrades. So I'm going to read to you from that, just to give you a texture and a sense of what is going on there. The terse typewritten note slipped under my door in a sealed envelope confirmed my appointment with India's single biggest internal security challenge, which is what the Prime Minister called the Maoists. I'd been waiting for months to hear from them. I had to be at the Ma Danteshwari Mandir, that's temple, in Dantewara, Chhattisgarh, at any 4 given times on 2 given days. That was to take care of bad weather, punctures, blockades, transport strikes, and sheer bad luck. The note said, writer should have camera, tikka, which is a bindi, and coconut. Meter will have cap, Hindi Outlook magazine, and bananas. The password will be Namaskar Guruji. Namaskar Guruji. I wondered whether the meter and greeter would be expecting a man and whether I should get myself a mustache. There are many ways to describe Dantewada. It's an oxymoron. It's a border town smack in the heart of India. It's the epicenter of a war. It's an upside-down, inside-out town. In Dantewada, the police wear plain clothes and the rebels wear uniforms. The jail superintendent is in jail and the prisoners are free. 300 of them escaped from the old town jail 2 years ago, but it's filled now again. Women who've been raped are in police custody. The rapists give speeches in the bazaar. Across the Indravati River, in the area controlled by the Maoists, is the place the police call Pakistan. There the villages are empty, but the forest is full of people. Children who ought to be in school run wild. In the lovely forest villages, the concrete school buildings have either been blown up and lie in a heap, or they are full of policemen. The deadly war that's unfolding in the jungle is a war that the government of India is both proud and shy of. Operation Green Hunt has been proclaimed as well as denied. P. Chidambaram, India's Home Minister and CEO of the war, says it does not exist, that it's a media creation. And yet, substantial funds have been allocated to it, and tens of thousands of troops are being mobilized for it. Though the theater of war is in the jungles of central India, it will have serious consequences for us all. If ghosts are the lingering spirits of someone or something that has ceased to exist, then perhaps the National Mineral Development Corporation's new four-lane highway crashing through the forest is the opposite of a ghost. Perhaps it's the harbinger of what is still to come. The antagonists in the forest are disparate and unequal in almost every way. On one side is a massive paramilitary force armed with the money, the firepower, the media, and the hubris of an emerging superpower. On the other, ordinary villagers armed with traditional weapons, backed by a superbly organized, hugely motivated Maoist guerrilla fighting force with an extraordinary and violent history of armed rebellion. The Maoists and the paramilitary are old adversaries and have fought older avatars of each other several times before. Telangana in the 50s, West Bengal, Bihar, Srikakulam in Andhra Pradesh in the late 60s and 70s, and then again Andhra Pradesh, Bihar, and Maharashtra in the 80s all the way through to the present. They are familiar with each other's tactics and have studied each other's combat manuals closely. Each time it seemed as though the Maoists or their previous avatars had not just been defeated, but literally physically exterminated. Each time they have re-emerged more organized, more determined, and more influential than ever. Today, the insurrection has spread through the mineral-rich forests of Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Orissa, and West Bengal, homeland to millions of India's tribal people, dreamland to the corporate world. It's easier on the liberal conscience to believe that the war in the forest is a war between the government of India and the Maoists, who call elections a sham, parliament a pigsty, and have openly declared their intention to overthrow the Indian state. It's convenient to forget that indigenous people in central India have a history of resistance that predates Mao by centuries. That's a truism, of course. If they didn't, they wouldn't exist. Their rebellions were cruelly crushed and many thousands killed, but the people were never conquered. Even after independence, tribal people were at the heart of the first uprising that could be described as Maoist in Naxalbari in the village West Bengal, where the word Naxalite, now used interchangeably with Maoist, originates. Since then, Naxalite politics has been inextricably entwined with tribal uprisings, which says as much about the tribals as it does about the Naxalites. This legacy of rebellion has left behind a furious people who have been deliberately isolated and marginalized by the Indian government. The Indian constitution, the moral underpinning of Indian democracy, was adopted by Parliament in 1950. It was a tragic day for indigenous people. The constitution ratified colonial policy and made the state custodian of tribal homelands. Overnight, it turned the entire indigenous population into squatters on their own land. It denied them their traditional rights to forest produce. It criminalized a whole way of life. In exchange for the right to vote, it snatched away their right to livelihood and dignity. Having dispossessed them and pushed them into a downward spiral of indigence in a cruel sleight of hand, the government began to use their own penury against them. Each time it needed to displace a large population for dams, irrigation projects, or mines, it talked of bringing tribals into the mainstream or of giving them the fruits of modern development. Of the tens of millions of internally displaced people, more than 30 million by big dams alone, refugees of India's progress, the great majority are tribal people. So when the government begins to talk of tribal welfare, it's time to worry. Over the past 5 years or so, the governments of Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Orissa, and West Bengal have signed hundreds of MOUs with corporate houses worth several billion rupees, all of them secret, for steel plants, sponge iron factories, power plants, aluminum refineries, dams, and mines. In order for the MOUs to be translated into real money, the people must be moved, and therefore this war. When a country that calls itself a democracy openly declares war within its borders, what does that war look like? Does the resistance stand a chance? Should it? Who are the Maoists? Are they just violent nihilists foisting an outdated ideology on tribal people, goading them into a hopeless insurrection? What lessons have they learned from their past experience? Is armed struggle intrinsically undemocratic? Is the sandwich theory of ordinary people being caught in the crossfire between the state and the Maoists an accurate one? Are Maoists and tribals two entirely discrete categories, as is being made out? Do their interests converge? Have they learned anything from each other? Have they changed each other? The day before I left, my mother called, sounding sleepy. I've been thinking, she said, with a mother's weird instinct, what this country needs is revolution. And an article on the internet says that Israel's Mossad is training 30 high-ranking Indian police officers in the techniques of targeted assassinations to render the Maoist organization headless. There's talk in the press about the new hardware that's been bought from Israel: laser rangefinders, thermal imaging equipment, and unmanned drones so popular with the US Army. Perfect weapons to use against the poor. I arrived at the Ma Danteshwari Mandir well in time for my appointment, first day, first show. I had my camera, my small coconut, and a powdery red tikka on my forehead. I wondered if someone was watching me and having a laugh. Within minutes, a young boy approached me. He had a cap and a backpack school bag, chipped red nail polish on his fingernails. No Hindi outlook, no bananas. "Are you the one who's going in?" he asked me. "No, namaskar, Guruji." I didn't know what to say. He took out a soggy note from his pocket and handed it to me. It said, "Outlook nahi mila." Couldn't find outlook. "And the bananas?" "I ate them," he said. "I got hungry." He really was a security threat. His backpack said, "Charlie Brown, not your ordinary blockhead." He said his name was Mangtu. I soon learned that the Dandakaranya, the forest I was about to enter, was full of people who had many names and fluid identities. It was like balm to me, that idea. How lovely not to be stuck with yourself, to become someone else for a while. We walked to the bus stand only a few minutes away from the temple. It was already crowded. Things happened quickly. There were two men on motorbikes. There was no conversation, just a glance of acknowledgement, a shifting of body weight, the revving of engines. I had no idea where we were going. We passed the house of the superintendent of police, which I recognized from my last visit. He was a candid man, the superintendent. "See, ma'am, frankly speaking, this problem can't be solved by us, police or military. The problem with these tribal people is they don't understand greed. Unless they become greedy, there's no hope for us. I have told my boss, remove the force and instead put a TV in every room, every home. Everything will be automatically sorted out." In no time at all, we were riding out of town. No tail. It was a long ride, 3 hours by my watch. It ended abruptly in the middle of nowhere, on an empty road with forest on either side. Mangtu got off, and I did too. The bikes left, and I picked up my backpack and followed the small internal security challenge into the forest. It was a beautiful day. The forest floor was a carpet of gold. In a while, we emerged on the white sandy banks of a broad flat river. It was obviously monsoon-fed, so now it was more or less a sand flat. At the center, a stream ankle-deep, easy to wade across. And across was Pakistan. "Out there, ma'am," the candid SP had said to me, "my boys shoot to kill." I remembered that as we began to cross. I saw us in a policeman's rifle sights, tiny figures in a landscape, easy to pick off. But Mangtu seemed quite unconcerned, and I took my cue from him. So, I could read a bit more, or do you want to chat?
Whatever you want to do.
Whatever.
Read some more.
Choices.
Oh, see, I heard about that. You're a Sagittarius too, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. This whole choosing thing is just impossible.
Okay.
And we Sagittariuses also do not like to be categorized.
Yeah. Are we terrorists or just militants? Okay, I'll read, because I actually prefer reading to talking, but it give you an idea of some of the issues that are involved, and then we'll talk, yeah? So, actually, after I walked into the forest, then we got lost, because the contact didn't arrive. So for two and a half days, we were walking, waiting, hoping, and then finally the contact was made. But then I'll just tell you about arriving at the camp first. So we're waiting in this village, and how it works is that a whole group of villages have a sort of young militia. They are called the Sangam, and they're not the PLGA, they're not the guerrilla army, they're just the people who are lookouts and who work with the villagers, who warn, because there's a serious siege. I'll come to that later, where basically shoot to kill means shoot to kill, and burn down villages, rape women, torture, all of that is going on. So this is my first encounter with the militia before I met the PLGA. About 20 young people arrive, girls and boys in their teens and early 20s. Chandu, who was one of the other guides, explains that this is the village-level militia, the lowest rung of the Maoist military hierarchy. I have never seen anyone like them before. They are dressed in saris and lungis, some in frayed olive-green fatigues. The boys wear jewelry and headgear. Every one of them has a muzzle-loading rifle, what's called a bharmar. Some also have knives, axes, a bow and arrow. One boy carries a crude mortar fashioned out of a heavy 3-foot galvanized iron pipe. It's filled with gunpowder and shrapnel and ready to be fired. It makes a big noise but can only be used once. Still, it scares the police, they say, and giggle. War doesn't seem to be uppermost on their minds, perhaps because their area is just outside the home range of the Salwa Judum. The Salwa Judum is the people's militia that has been raised by the government of tribal people. You know, it's like pitting indigenous people against indigenous people. They've just finished a day's work helping to build fencing around some village houses to keep the goats out of the fields. They're full of fun and curiosity. The girls are confident and easy with the boys. I have a sensor for this sort of thing and I'm impressed. Their job, Chandu says, is to patrol and protect a group of 4 or 5 villages and to help in the fields, clean wells or repair houses, doing whatever is needed. After dinner, without much talk, everyone falls in line. Clearly, we're moving. Everything moves with us, the rice, vegetables, pots and pans. We leave the school compound and walk single file into the forest. In less than half an hour, we arrive in a glade where we're going to sleep. There's absolutely no noise. Within minutes, everyone has spread their blue plastic sheets, the ubiquitous jilli, without which there will be no revolution. Chandu and Mangtu share one and spread one out for me. They find me the best place by the best gray rock. Chandu says he sent a message to the comrades. If they get it, they'll be there first thing in the morning, if they get it. It's the most beautiful room I've slept in a long time, my private suite in a 1,000-star hotel. I'm surrounded by these strange, beautiful children with their curious arsenal. They're all Maoists for sure. Are they all going to die? Is the jungle warfare college for them? And the helicopter gunships, the thermal imaging, and the laser rangefinders? Why must they die? What for? To turn all of this into a mine? I remember my visit to the open cast ore mines in Orissa. There was a forest there once and children like these, but now the land is like a raw red wound. Dust fills your nostrils and lungs. The water is red, the air is red, the people are red, their lungs and hair are red. All day and all night, trucks rumble through their villages, bumper to bumper, thousands and thousands of trucks, carrying iron ore to Paradip port, from where it will go to China. And there it'll turn into cars and smoke and sudden cities that spring up overnight, into a growth rate that leaves economists breathless, into weapons that make war. Everyone's asleep except for the sentries who take 1.5-hour shifts. Finally, I can look at the stars. When I was a child growing up on the banks of the Meenachal River, I used to think the sound of crickets, which always started up at twilight, was the sound of stars revving up, getting ready to shine. I'm surprised at how much I love being here. There's nowhere else in the world that I would rather be. Who should I be tonight? Comrade Rahel under the stars. Maybe the comrades will come tomorrow. They arrive early in the morning. I can see them from a distance, about 15 of them, all in olive green uniforms running towards us. Even from a distance, from the way they run, I can tell they are the heavy hitters, the People's Liberation Guerrilla Army, the PLGA, for whom the thermal imaging and laser guided rifles, for whom the jungle warfare school. They carry serious rifles, in SAS SLR to have AK-47s. The leader of the squad is Comrade Madhav, who's been with the party since he was 9. He's from Warangal, Andhra Pradesh. These comrades have been in the forest for 30 years, working among the people. He's upset and extremely apologetic. There was a major miscommunication, he says again and again, which usually never happens. I was supposed to have arrived at the main camp on the first night, but someone dropped the baton. We made you wait, we made you walk so much, we ran all the way when the message came that you were here. I said it was okay, that I'd come prepared to walk and wait and listen. It's a few hours' walk to the camp. It's getting dark when we arrive. There are several layers of sentries and concentric circles of patrolling. There must be 100 comrades lined up in 2 rows. Everyone has a weapon and a smile. They begin to sing, Lal Lal Salam, Lal Lal Salam. Aane wale saathiyon ko Lal Lal Salam. Red salute to the comrades who have arrived. It was sung sweetly as though it were a folk song about a river or a forest blossom. With the song, the greeting, the handshake, the clenched fist. Other than that, a large blue jhali spread out on the floor about 15 feet square. There are no signs of a camp. This one has a jhali roof as well. It's my room for the night. I was either being rewarded for my day's walking or being pampered in advance for what lay ahead, or both. Either way, it was the last time in the entire trip I was going to have a roof over my head. Over dinner, I meet Comrade Narmada in charge of the Krantikari Adivasi Mahila Sangathan, which means the Revolutionary Indigenous Women's Association, which has 90,000 members, who has a price on her head. Comrade Saroja of the PLGA, who's only as tall as her SLR. Comrade Mase, which means black girl in Gondi, who has a price on her head too. Comrade Rupi, the tech wizard. Comrade Raju, who's in charge of the division I'd be walking through. Between us, we speak Gondi, Halbi, Telugu, Punjabi, and Malayalam. Only Mase speaks English, so we all communicate in Hindi. Comrade Mase is tall and quiet and seems to have to swim through a layer of pain to enter the conversation. But from the way she hugs me, I can tell she's a reader and that she misses having books in the jungle. She will tell me her story only later when she trusts me with her grief. Bad news arrives as it does in this jungle. A runner with biscuits, which are handwritten notes on sheets of paper folded and stapled into little squares. There's a bag full of them, like chips. News from everywhere. The police have killed 5 people in Ongnar village, 4 from the militia and 1 ordinary villager. On the radio, there's news about the Home Minister's meeting with chief ministers of the states affected by, quote, left-wing extremism. The chief ministers of Jharkhand and Bihar are being demure and haven't attended. Everyone sitting around the radio laughs. Around the time of elections, they say, right through the campaign, and then maybe a month or two after the government is formed, mainstream politicians all say things like, Naxals are our children. You can set your watch to the schedule of when they will change their minds and grow fangs and start to kill. Should we chat and then I'll read a bit?
That sounds great. So one of the sentences that you said that you heard a lot is, we'll give away our lives but never our land. So can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah. Well, you know, before I went into the forest and marched with the comrades for many, many years, I mean more than 10 years ago, I was writing about perhaps the biggest non-violent Gandhian anti-dam movement, the Narmada Bachao Andolan. I think, in fact, I'm not sure, but I think I've spoken here about it many years ago in this auditorium, maybe. But as I said, you know, dams, just dams alone have displaced more than 30 million people. So one, and today with the neoliberal economic policies, the biggest issue that is causing unrest across the country is displacement and the takeover of people's lands. In the Narmada movement, you know, people would stand in their homes while the river rose and basically, you know, to protest in those ways. It just didn't matter. The dams just kept going up. Today, they are building about 100 dams in the Himalayas in Arunachal Pradesh, which is a very thinly populated area. And the trouble is that in a place like this, in Dandakaranya, when it's mining companies that want to take over your land, if you're organized, you can defend your land. But if it's a question of a dam, let's say the biggest dam on the Narmada Valley project, the Sardar Sarovar Dam, the dam is being built in Gujarat, which is a completely fascist state. But the submergence, the reservoir is in the other states, in Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. And you know, it's not as though people are coming to take over your land. The thing you love the most, your river is rising to take over the land. You can't shoot the river. You can't blow up the river. You know, how do you fight a dam? You can fight it if you prevent it from being built in the first place, but if it's being built, they can secure the site, you know, militarily, as they are in the Northeast. So, but if you look at the history of struggle for land in India, what is really sad is that in the 1970s, well, let's say after India became independent, land reform was one of the biggest things on the agenda of the new government, which was, of course, obviously subverted by all the politicians who were upper caste people, who were landowners, who were what we call zamindars. So they put in so many caveats in the legal system that absolutely no redistribution really happened. But then in the 1970s, when this Naxalite movement started, when the first people rose up, it was about the redistribution of land. It was saying land to the tiller, you know, and it was crushed. The army was called out. The Indian government, which calls itself democratic, never hesitates to call out the army. So the army was called out, this movement was crushed. But today, people have forgotten, completely forgotten the idea of redistribution. They are just fighting to be allowed to hold on to what little they have, you know, and we call that progress, because the home minister says he wants 70% of India to live in cities. That means he wants 500 to 600 million people to move. How do you do that unless you become a military state? How do you do that unless you build big dams and big thermal projects and have nuclear power, you know? So really, in so many ways, we have regressed. And even the most radical politics, like this that I'm writing about, is still about people who are privileged enough to have land. But there are millions and millions of people who don't have land, who now just live as pools of underpaid wage labor on the edges of these huge megalopolises that make up India now. So the politics of land in one way is radical, and in another way it's left out the poorest people, because they are just out of the equation. We don't talk about justice anymore. None of us do. We just talk about human rights or survival, you know. We don't talk about redistribution. I mean, in America, 400 people own the wealth of more than half of the American population. So we should be not saying tax the rich, we should be saying take their money and redistribute it. Yeah. Take their property and redistribute it.
So I think you just answered this, but I'm going to ask it anyway because I love this sentence you wrote. Justice, that grand, beautiful idea, has been whittled down to mean human rights.
Yeah, and of those, George Bush said, a few will do. Yeah, I mean, that is right. You know, I actually hate this word, human rights. You know, what does it mean? What does it mean? You know, the idea of justice. And that's why when I was talking about the fact that we can't just isolate the idea of environmental battles, we have to have at the keystone of the arc has to be the idea of justice, you know. So it has to be, because all these things eventually do coincide. In India, at still, I mean, I would still say that environmentalists as a group are pretty reviled by people's movements because they are elitists, you know. They are the ones who want the national parks emptied so that you can save the tiger. They don't understand the meaning of justice at all, you know. So, in fact, these wars, like the one that I'm talking about, are battles in which people are also part of the ecosystem. I mean, later on, when I read you more, I will talk about the fact that, you know, as a person who stands on this side of the line with this bandwidth of resistance movements, I do turn around and ask the comrades some questions, such as, will you leave the bauxite in the mountain? You know, today, among the biggest battles that's been fought in India is over the extraction of bauxite, which is the ore that makes aluminium, which is at the center of the military-industrial complex. And bauxite is the process, we have something like $4 trillion worth of bauxite in the mountains of Orissa and Chhattisgarh, and bauxite mountains are beautiful mountains. They are flat-top mountains, porous. Bauxite is a porous rock, and when it rains, those bauxite mountains absorb the water. They're like water tanks, and then they let the water out through their toes, and they irrigate the plains. And for mining companies who have bought the bauxite for a small royalty to the Indian government, and they've already traded it on the futures market. So for local people, the bauxite in the mountain is the source of their life and their future and their religion and everything. And for the aluminium company, the mountain is just a cheap storage facility, you know. So it has to come out. They've already sold it. So it has to come out, either peacefully or violently. And so now the Indian government, the largest democracy in the world, is planning to call out the army in central India to fight the poorest people in the world.
You mentioned earlier Gandhian tactics. And
why are you smiling?
And you said that Gandhian satyagraha is a kind of political theater. In order for it to be effective, it needs a sympathetic audience, which villagers deep in the forest don't have. When a posse of 800 policemen lay a cordon around a forest village at night and begin to burn houses and shoot people, will a hunger strike help? Can starving people go on a hunger strike? And do hunger strikes work when they're not on TV?
Yeah, I said that, I admit. see, I think that When we were talking earlier about different strategies of resistance and the overground and the underground and things, these are very live debates in India right now, not just between the government or academic, but even between resistance movements. There's very real tension, because sometimes an armed guerrilla action can be extremely irresponsible. You know, it can go and do something which invites the kind of repression from the state or from even, let's say, you know, the fascist Hindu militias who are also operating on behalf of the state. A lot of the Indian government's violence and repression is outsourced to the mob. It's not always acting as the state, you know. So there are these very real tensions, and often, you know, academics or journalists or these, you know, moronic anchors in TV studios, they will, you know, initiate a debate based on, you know, is violence moral or immoral, and, you know, SMS your answer to the studio now, whatever. But actually, people don't necessarily function like that. You know, you can be a Maoist in the forest and a Gandhian on the street and a, you know, hunger striker. You can change identity depending on what suits you tactically. You don't have to, it's not like you've got to swear to be either this thing or that thing or the other thing, necessarily. Some people do, some people don't. But I think what happens in India is that this debate is, there's something false about it, you know, because it's infused with a kind of false morality. After all, if people from the middle class were to support Adiva, I mean, it's an oxymoron, they won't, but supposing they were to support that fight, then I can understand you saying, okay, let's all get together and, you know, go on a hunger strike. But if you're going to distance yourself from that village that has been surrounded by 1,000 policemen and is being burned, then it's immoral to try and lecture to those people how they should protect themselves. You know? So I just want to read a little bit about that, which it's a part of this essay which got me into a lot of delicious trouble. We're moving in single file now. Myself and 100 senselessly violent, bloodthirsty insurgents. I looked around at the camp before we left. There are no signs that almost 100 people had camped here, except for some ash where the fires had been. I cannot believe this army. As far as consumption goes, it's more Gandhian than any Gandhian, and has a lighter carbon footprint than any climate change evangelist. But for now, it even has a Gandhian approach to sabotage. Before a police vehicle is burnt, for example, it is stripped down and every part is cannibalized. The steering wheel is straightened out and made into a Bharmar barrel. The Rexine upholstery stripped and used for ammunition pouches. The battery for solar charging. The new instructions from the High Command are that captured vehicles should be buried and not cremated, so they can be resurrected when needed. Should I write a play, I wonder? Gandhi, get your gun. Or will I be lynched? We're walking in pitch darkness and dead silence. I'm the only one using a torch pointed down so that all I can see in its circle of light are Comrade Kamla's bare heels in her scuffed black chappals, showing me exactly where to put my feet. She's carrying 10 times more weight than I am, her backpack, a rifle, a huge bag of provisions on her head, one of the large cooking pots, and two shoulder bags full of vegetables. The bag on her head is perfectly balanced, and she can scramble down slopes and slippery rock pathways without so much as touching it. She's a miracle. It turns out to be a long walk. I'm grateful to the okay, that's referring to something else. It's the most wonderful thing, walking in the forest at night, and I'll be doing it night after night.
I think I have one more question for now.
Yeah.
Which is, I have to be honest and say that a lot of what we're talking about here today and a lot of what I write about scares me. And I'm wondering, I'm wondering if you get scared. For me, it's not so much quite the implications as it is state repression.
Yeah. The thing is that, often people describe me as brave, and I find that, gives me a rash, because I think it's really important to be scared, you know. It's really important to know what you're up against. And it's really important not to have a martyr complex. You know, it's important not to want to go to jail. It's important not to want to die, you know. And yet, to do what you have to do, to be effective, and to know what you're good at doing, you know. Like, to be honest, when I was in the forest, I was born I grew up in a village, in a small village in South India, and for me it was lovely just to be in the forest and to have only whatever it was that I carried on my back. And I told them, shall I just stay here? So they said, no, we don't want you, because you've got to do what you've got to do, you know, and you've got to do what you're effective at doing. And I think of it as a kind of waltz, you know. You've got to know when to step forward and when to step back and when to wait and when to move and to enjoy it, you know. But the thing is that quite often, I mean, both inside the forest, and often when I go to Kashmir, you know, when you see what is being done to people, and here maybe you don't see it so directly, but there you just see it so brutally. When you see what's being done to people, the rage that it creates in you, and the humiliation of keeping quiet. People ask me why you write. I say, just in order not to be humiliated, you know. I don't write for anything else except not to be humiliated. And I think there's a and every time I write, I keep telling myself I won't do it again, you know, because it's almost like when you can't contain it inside your body, then you write, and it's a relief. But I think it's important to be scared. I mean, to answer your question, I think it's important to be scared, and I won't say that I'm not scared, but I suspect that I'm more scared of keeping quiet, because as a writer, if you know something and then you keep quiet, it's like dying, you know. So between the various choices of fear, as a Sagittarian who hates to choose, I still choose to write rather than not write, you know.
Thank you.
Yeah, I thought I'd just read a little bit about, I mean, to just give you a sense of scale of what is happening in Chhattisgarh. When they created this people's militia, the Salva Judum, in effect, it swept through the forest, burning and looting and emptying something like 644 villages, which was 350,000 people, who were 50,000 were moved into sort of police camps, and from those they raised a militia of SPOs that are special police officers, and 300,000 just sort of disappeared. You know, some people migrated to other states, some people are living in fear in the forest. So I'll just read so that you could get an idea of the texture of what's going on there. The Salva Judum was a ground clearing operation meant to move people out of their villages into roadside camps where they could be policed and controlled. In military terms, it's called strategic hamleting. It was devised by General Sir Harold Briggs in 1950 when the British were at war against the communists in Malaya. The Briggs plan became very popular with the Indian Army, which has used it in Nagaland, Mizoram, and Telangana. The BJP Chief Minister of Chhattisgarh, BJP is the right-wing Bharatiya Janata Party, the right-wing Hindu party, Raman Singh, announced that as far as his government was concerned, villagers who did not move into the camps would be considered Maoists. So in Bastar, for an ordinary villager just staying at home, living an ordinary life, became the equivalent of indulging in terrorist activity. So you can imagine, the constitution first criminalizes their way of life and makes them criminals, and now they've graduated into being terrorists. Along with a steel mug of black tea as a special treat, someone hands me a pair of earphones and switches on a little MP3 player. It's a scratchy recording of the then superintendent of police of Bijapur, D.S. Manhar, briefing a junior officer over the wireless about the rewards and incentives the state and central governments are offering to Jagrit, as in awakened villages, meaning the villagers who agree to move out are being given incentives. He then gives clear instructions that villagers that refuse to surrender should be burnt, and journalists who want to cover Naxalites should be shot on sight. I'd read about this in the papers long ago. When the story broke, rumor has it that as a punishment, it's not clear to whom, the superintendent was transferred to the State Human Rights Commission. The Salva Judum was announced at a meeting of village mukhyas, village heads, in a village called Ambeli in June 2005. Between June and December, it burned, killed, raped, and looted its way through hundreds of villages of South Dantewara. The center of its operations were Bijapur and Bhairamgarh, near Bela Dila, where the SR Steel's new plant was proposed. Not coincidentally, those were also Maoist strongholds where the Jantana Sarkar, the people's governments, had done a great deal of work building water harvesting structures. The Jantana Sarkars became the special target of the Salva Judum's attack. Hundreds of people were killed in the most brutal ways. About 60,000 moved into camps, some voluntarily, others out of terror. Of these, about 3,000 were appointed as special police officers on a salary of 1,500 rupees, which is about $40 a month. The remaining hundreds of thousands of people went off the government radar. Many of them made their way to neighboring states where they usually migrated to work as contract labor during the chili picking season. But tens of thousands fled into the forest where they still remain, living without shelter, coming back to their fields and homes only in the daytime. In the slipstream of the Salva Judum, a swarm of police stations and camps appeared. The idea was to provide carpet security for a creeping reoccupation of Maoist-controlled territory. The assumption was that the Maoists would not dare to attack such a large concentration of security forces. The Maoists, for their part, realized that if they did not break that carpet security, it would amount to abandoning people whose trust they had earned and with whom they had lived and worked for 25 years. They struck back in a series of attacks on the heart of the security grid. On the 26th of January 2006, the PLGA attacked the Gangalore police camp and killed 7 people. On 17th July 2006, the Salvajurum camp at Erabor was attacked and 20 people were killed and 150 injured. You might have read about it, something like Maoists attacked the relief camp set up by the state government to provide shelter to the villagers who had fled from their villages because of terror unleashed by the Naxalites. On 13th December 2006, they attacked the Basaguda relief camp and killed 3 special police officers and a constable. On the 15th of March 2007 came the most audacious attack of them all. 120 PLGA guerrillas attacked the Rani Bodali Kanya Ashram, a girls' hostel that had been converted into a barrack for 80 Chhattisgarh police and SPOs, while the girls still lived in it as human shields. The PLGA entered the compound, cordoned off the annex in which the girls lived, and attacked the barracks. 55 policemen and SPOs were killed. None of the girls were hurt. The attack on Rani Bodali caused an uproar in the country. Human rights organizations condemned the Maoists, not just for their violence, but also for being anti-education and attacking schools. By the way, all the schools in the area are used as barracks for security forces. But in Dandakaranya, the Rani Bodali attack became a legend. Songs and poems and plays were written about it. The Maoist counter-offensive did break the carpet security and give people breathing space. The police and the Salvajurum retreated into their camps, from which they now emerge, usually in the dead of night, in packs of 300 or 1,000 to carry out cordon and search operations in villages. Gradually, except for the SPOs and their families, the rest of the people in the Salvajurum began to return to their villages. The Maoists welcomed them back and announced that even SPOs could return if they genuinely and publicly regretted their actions. Young people began to flock to the PLGA. The Salvajurum had not just failed, it had backfired badly. But as we know now, it was not just a local operation by a small-time hood. Regardless of the double speak in the press, the Salvajurum was a joint operation by the state government of Chhattisgarh and the Congress Party, which was in power at the center. It could not be allowed to fail. Not when all those MOUs were still waiting like wilting hopefuls on the marriage market. The government was under tremendous pressure to come up with a new plan. They came up with Operation Green Hunt. The Salvajurum SPOs are called Koya Commandos now. But the government has deployed the Chhattisgarh Armed Force, the Central Reserve Police Force, the Border Security Force, the Indo-Tibetan Border Police, the Central Industrial Security Force, Greyhounds, Scorpions, Cobras, and a policy that's affectionately called WHAM, Winning Hearts and Minds. Significant wars are often fought in unlikely places. Free market capitalism defeated Soviet communism in the bleak mountains of Afghanistan. Here in the forests of Dantewada, a battle rages for the soul of India. Plenty has been said about the deepening crisis in Indian democracy and the collusion between big corporations, the media, major political parties, and the security establishment. If anyone wants to do a quick spot check, Dantewada is the place to go. a draft report on the state agrarian relations and the unfinished task of land reform said that Tata Steel and SR Steel were the first financiers of the Salwa Jurum. It was a government report and it created a flurry, so that fact was subsequently dropped. Was it a genuine error or did someone receive a gentle integrated steel tap on the shoulder? On the 12th of October 2009, at the mandatory public hearing for the Tata Steel plant meant to be held in Lohandigura, where local people could come, actually took place in a small hall inside the collectorate in Jagdalpur, many miles away, cordoned off with massive security. A hired audience of 50 tribal people was brought in a guarded convoy of government jeeps. After the meeting, the district collector congratulated the people of Lohandigura for their cooperation. The local newspapers reported the lie, even though they knew better, but the advertisements rolled in. And despite villagers' objections, land acquisition for the project began. The Maoists are not the only ones who seek to depose the Indian state. It's already been deposed several times by Hindu fundamentalism and economic totalitarianism. Lohandigura, a five-hour drive from Dantewada, never used to be a Naxalite area, but it is now. Comrade Juri, who sat next to me while I ate the red ant chutney, works in the area. She said they decided to move in after graffiti had begun to appear on the walls of village houses, saying, "Naxali ao, hame bachao, Naxals come and save us." A few months ago, Vimal Meshram, vice president of the Janpad Panchayat, was shot dead in the market. He was Tata's man, Juri says. He was forcing people to give up their land and accept compensation. It's good that he's been finished. "Do you want some more chapoli," which is the chutney? She's crunching red ants. "We won't let the Tatas come here. People don't want them." Juri's not PLGA. She's in the Chetna Natya Manch, the cultural wing of the party. She sings and writes songs. She's from Abujmar. I feel I ought to say something at this point about the futility of violence, about the unacceptability of summary executions. But what should I suggest they do? Go to court, do a hunger strike in Jantar Mantar, a rally, a relay hunger strike? It sounds ridiculous. The promoters of the new economic policy, who find it so easy to say there is no alternative, should be asked to suggest an alternative resistance policy, a specific one to these specific people in this specific forest, here, now. Which party should they vote for? Which democratic institution in this country should they approach? Which door did the Narmada Andolan not knock on during the years and years it fought against big dams on the Narmada?
Oh, my favorite one for last one. So, do you want to do the last one? Or do you want to read more?
No, I can read the last.
Well, you can read more too. I'm not trying to kick you off.
No.
It's whatever you want to do, it's great. As long as you do the last one.
Yeah, I will. Well, I just want to say, I think before I read the last bit of my book, that for many years I have been writing and following resistance movements and the new economic policy and all of that. And I've always found that the chances of coming upon despair are much greater in middle class households than on the ground where people are actually fighting, because middle class people have the choice between hope and despair, you know, just like they have the choice between shampoo for dry hair or, you know, oily hair or whatever it is. they have the choice between doing politics or doing interior design, but people who are fighting, you know, they really don't have a choice. They are fighting and they are focused and they know what they're doing. They're arguing, of course, with each other a lot, but that's all right. When I came here to America, when I landed in New York, one of the first things I did was to go to the Wall Street occupation, because I wanted to see what was it? I mean, who were they, and what is that about, and how does it connect to the things that we've been fighting and writing about? And you know, clearly, whatever all the various strands are, and the fact that they don't have demands, and the fact that it doesn't have you know, identifiable leaders, still there is a connection between what's going on there and what's going on here, and that connection is that of exclusion. These are people who are excluded. I mean, they are clearly not the 400 families who own half the wealth of America, and they are not the 100 people in India who own 25% of India's GDP. So, you know, while all of us are people who believe in something, I mean, I think all of us in this room anyway are people who believe in revolution, who believe that the system must be brought down. But right now, for the moment at least, I was thinking that the least we can ask for to begin with is that there has to be a cap on all of this, you know, there has to be a lid on it. And I thought I'm a capist and a Lidite. and we do need to say a few things, you know. One is that no individual can have an unlimited amount of wealth. No corporation can have an unlimited amount of wealth. And this sort of cross-ownership of businesses really has to stop. You know, in India there are so many, of course. The Tatas are the biggest company. They own iron ore mines, steel mines, iodized salt, television channels. They manufacture trucks. They fund activists. They do everything, you know. So there's an iron ore and steel plant, a steel company called Jindal's. They have iron ore mines, steel mines. The CEO is in parliament, he's a member of parliament. He's also the member of the National Flag Foundation because he won the right to fly the national flag on his house. They run a global law school just outside Delhi, which is like a Stanford campus in the midst of the most unbelievable squalor you can imagine, where they have faculty from all over the world paid huge salaries. They fund and promote cutting-edge artists who work in stainless steel. And they recently had a protest workshop. You know, so they flew in activists into this unbelievably posh campus, and then you had sort of protest poetry and protest slogans, and so they own everything. They own the resistance, they own the mines, they own the parliament, they own the flag, they own the newspapers. You know, they don't let anything go. So, you know, these are some simple things that have to stop. That you just can't. Berlusconi owns 90% of the media in Italy, so what if he's not the prime minister, you know? So it's a kind of insanity that's set in, which could have some simple solutions too. Like, for example, perhaps children shouldn't inherit the wealth their parents amass, you know? So I'm just going to read the end of the book, and then I'll go away. Can we expect that an alternative to what looks like certain death for the planet will come from the imagination that has brought about this crisis in the first place? It seems unlikely. The alternative, if there is one, will emerge from the places and the people who have resisted the hegemonic impulse of capitalism and imperialism instead of being co-opted by it. Here in India, even in the midst of all the violence and greed, there is still hope. If anyone can do it, we can. We still have a population that has not been completely colonized by that consumerist dream. We still have a living tradition of those who have struggled for Gandhi's vision of sustainability and self-reliance, for socialist ideas of egalitarianism and social justice. We have Ambedkar's vision, which challenges the Gandhians as well as the socialists in serious ways. We have the most spectacular coalition of resistance movements with their experience, understanding, and vision. Most important of all, India has a surviving Adivasi, that's an indigenous population of almost 100 million. They're the ones who still know the secrets of sustainable living. If they disappear, they will take those secrets with them. Wars like Operation Green Hunt will make them disappear. So victories for the prosecutors of this war will contain within itself seeds of destruction, not just for Adivasis, but eventually for the human race. That's why the war in Central India is so important. That's why we need real and urgent conversations between all those political formations that are resisting this war. The day capitalism is forced to tolerate non-capitalist societies in its midst and to acknowledge limits in its quest for domination, the day it is forced to recognize that its supply of raw material will not be endless, is the day when change will come. If there is any hope for the world at all, it does not live in climate change conference rooms or in cities with tall buildings. It lives low down on the ground with its arms around the people who go to battle every day to protect their forests, their mountains, and their rivers, because they know that the forests, the mountains, and rivers protect them. The first step towards reimagining a world gone terribly wrong would be to stop the annihilation of those who have a different imagination, an imagination that is outside of capitalism as well as communism, an imagination which has an altogether different understanding of what constitutes happiness and fulfillment. To gain this philosophical space, it is necessary to concede some physical space for the survival of those who may look like the keepers of our past, but who may really be the guides to our future. To do this, we have to ask our rulers, can you leave the water in the rivers, the trees in the forest? Can you leave the bauxite in the mountain? If they say they cannot, then perhaps they should stop preaching morality to the victims of their wars. Thank you.